let me begin by reading out the Inclusive Church Statement. I love your statement. It reflects much of what is at the heart of Christian A's calling. We believe in an inclusive church, church which does not discriminate on any level on grounds of economic power, gender, mental health, physical ability, race or sexuality. We believe in church which welcomes and serves all people in the name of Jesus Christ, which is scripturally faithful, which seeks to proclaim the gospel afresh for each generation, and which in the power of the Holy Spirit allows all people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Jesus Christ. Amen to that. And hence, it is with sadness that I say this. At Christian Aid, our experiences of working with people in poverty have demonstrated that at every level, from the household to the global stage, in politics and in personal life, in economics and in health, in culture and in decision making, people of one gender are poorer, disadvantaged and less powerful than another. For that reason, we at Christian Aid often say that yes, poverty has a woman's face. Today, around 700 million people live below the global poverty line on less than $1.90 a day. Tonight, they will go to bed hungry. It's been estimated that around 70% of these people, over two-thirds of the world's extreme poor, are women and girls. Women represent half the world's population, perform nearly two-thirds of its work hours, receive 10% of its income, and own less than 1% of the world's property. Women's wages worldwide are 17% lower than those of men for equal work. And those jobs that they do are more likely to be low paid, low status and vulnerable jobs with limited or no social protection or basic rights. Globally, only 18% of chief executives are women. In the UK, 46 years after the Equal Pay Act was passed, women are still paid 17.5% less than men. And we here face this reality. We know that we as people of faith, as believers in the one body, must work for the transformation of global society so that the world becomes an inclusive place where women and men may flourish and live in peace with one another. My own personal and professional experience is itself a story about gender, so allow me to share a little of that. When I was young, the idea that I could ever be standing in front of you as the chief executive of a large international development organisation would have been thought of as little more than an idle fantasy. I was born into an Italian family with all the accompanying pressures you might expect in 1960s Britain. In the Isle of Wight, being Italian was something out of the ordinary, a little bit exotic. I come from an ice cream family, certainly not the standard fit for aspiring to any serious role. My first job was as a preschooler, turning the jingle on and off on my dad's ice cream van. When at 14 I told the school careers advisor that I wanted to be a barrister or possibly a diplomat, I was told that both would probably be too difficult, and anyway I wasn't English enough for the second. I should pursue speech therapy in the light of what was then a national shortage. My career aspirations were unusual for a young girl of Italian origins who might have been expected to concentrate on finding a nice Italian boy to settle down with. One of the men in my extended family, on hearing me express some rather forthright views about business as a young teenager, advised me in no uncertain terms that because I was a girl, having a view on anything much was not welcome, that I should concentrate on trying to make myself less physically unattractive, and that if I didn't keep myself to myself, I would never get a husband. Luckily, my parents were really keen to support my ambitions, and after a law degree at university, I qualified as a solicitor, despite having to field illegal questions from some law firms along the way about whether there was really any point in training me if I was only going to have children. I moved from legal practice into financial regulation, both male-dominated environments. Even coming to my present role at Christian Aid, I find this sector at senior levels is still dominated by men. But hey, here I am in one of the most amazing roles you could hope for, leading an organisation of over 900 staff and over 600 partner organisations across the world committed to ending global poverty, including the gender inequality that helps to drive it. And very soon my daughter is about to start her legal training, and you can be sure that no one asked her an illegal question when she went for her interviews for a training contract. And no career advisor ever suggested that her choice was beyond her, nor did any family member suggest that she should concentrate on landing a husband. Neither she nor I have progressed on our own. We stand on the shoulders of many brave people, mainly but not exclusively women, who have battled to make it possible for women like us to have aspirations which even a generation before us would have been unrealistic. And we have depended on the encouragement of so many others all along the way. Each one of you is playing a part in that. Of course, even in Britain, even on the day when we have our second female Prime Minister, gender equality is still not a reality, but progress has been made. Together we've achieved so much. We know too, though, as Diana said earlier, we know that here and across the world, there is so much more to do. The facts and figures that I shared with you earlier could lead us to believe that inequality is about money, that poverty is about money, and hence that we can kind of buy our way out of it. Just enough aid, just enough donations. But we can't. For although in the developing world, a woman dies every 90 seconds as a result of childbirth, this is not simply for the lack of health facilities. It's because a woman's ability to access reproductive health services depends not primarily on the existence of the service, but on whether her husband will allow her to control her own body, use contraception, and travel to a family planning clinic. We know that the same girl who is forced into an early marriage is the same girl who will be forced into a lifetime of unpaid domestic labour, who will not be given the opportunity to go to school, who may be forced to have her genitals mutilated, and when her husband finally dies, will be denied the right to inherit any property. For many, it's a form of slavery, for which the dawn of emancipation from birth to death hardly even flickers. For Christian Aid, ending gender inequality, and indeed all forms of poverty, is not about the number of schools or clinics built. It's about redressing fundamental imbalances of power. It's about giving people in poverty, and especially women, voice, choice, and control over their own lives. Because as a Christian organisation, we believe that each person is made in the image of God, and hence that every person, irrespective of race, creed, colour, gender, or sexuality, anything else about them, is a person of inherent dignity and infinite worth. I want to share with you our theological understanding in more detail. And if you want to read into it, I'm drawing heavily here on the work of Susan Derber, then our theology coordinator when she wrote this, in our publication of The Same Flesh, which is the one over there that you're welcome to take with you, or if you'd rather read it online, it's on our website. We start with a verse often cited as significant for a theology of gender, wherever you stand on the theology of gender, Genesis 1:27. So God created humankind in his image. In the image of God, he created them, male and female, he created them. This verse offers a picture of humankind being created as the last part of God's creation, and most significantly, not simply after its own kind or like itself, but made in the image of God. What this being in the image of God precisely implies is not explained. This verse should perhaps be read in the context of those many verses in the Old Testament that stress to us that God cannot be looked at, nor can we know what God looks like. It is striking that it's both male and female together who are described as being in the image of God, so that no one human being can be this image alone. There is a ready-made protection against idolatry. But it's astonishingly difficult for those who read this verse often, and for whom it's become almost a kind of slogan, to feel today quite the force and ground-shaking impact that it must have had in its original context. There were societies in the ancient Near East, like the Babylonians, who believed that not all that exists was good, that some things that existed were actually bad. And against that background, this verse, which seems now blandly obvious to us, was profoundly significant. The whole account of creation, in the first chapter of Genesis, emphasizes right from the beginning that God made everything and that it was all good. God made the light, the darkness, too, the land, the water. Significantly, in terms of the theology of gender, God made male and female, and both are good. This was such an unusual and astonishing idea for the ancient world, perhaps still sometimes today, but its full significance is hard to grasp. And the second account of creation, the one often presented as the story of Adam and Eve, has a similarly significant message. In Genesis 2, we read how the Lord God formed a human being from the dust of the ground and breathed into its nostrils the breath of life. And then further on in the story, we read that God decided it was not good for the creature to be alone. When the human being could not find anyone from among the animals or birds to be a companion, God took one of the creature's ribs and made another human being, and they were one flesh. What's much clearer in the original Hebrew, in which this story is written, is that the first creature that God made was simply an earthling. This is what Adam means in Hebrew, a creature from the earth. It's only when the second creature is made, when the first one is divided to make two, that the new words for man and woman are used. And the very significant thing about this passage for us is the way in which the relationship between the now differentiated man and woman are described. The earthling needs to find relationship and someone to heal loneliness. None of the creatures already made will do, so God makes the earthling into two. And yet two who are so completely of the same being that the earth creature can say, "This at last is bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh." The message of this story for us is that not that woman was derived from man, or that woman is secondary, or even really that woman is so different from man. We think that what the reader is to understand is that woman and man, female and male, are more like each other than they are different. They have a deep and essential unity with one another, being from the same source. They have something like common ground. And this kind of unity is what gives them a deep-rooted equality of dignity and worth. A further source of reflection on gender, just as radical and transformative as those key texts in the book of Genesis, comes in Jesus himself. The Gospels bear witness to a Jesus who lived out an alternative masculinity, related to women in ways that absolutely embodied the joy and justice of our creation as male and female, both in the image of God. Jesus lived in a context in which human beings exercised power over others in a multitude of ways. Divisions ran deep between Gentile and Jew, between Jew and Samaritan, between slaves and owners, between ruling Romans and subject peoples. There were multiple causes of discrimination, oppression and injustice, many intersecting identities. But in each particular culture, it was the case that men held power over women. We see this reflected in the gospel narratives in which women are often unnamed, voiceless, cast either as wives or prostitutes. But Jesus subverts and challenges the default gender narrative. It's clear in the Gospels that Jesus often seems to go to the places where women are. There are women among his closest friends. He speaks to them in public, even though it was seen as improper. He acknowledges that they can be prophetic, encourages Mary, the sister of Martha, to listen to his teaching in a way traditionally reserved for male disciples. He heals women, he gives them dignity. If the world told women to be silent, it's Jesus who entrusts them with the task of proclaiming the resurrection. Jesus also emerges from the pages of the Gospel as a remarkable kind of man, subverting traditional understandings of masculinity. This is really important for the way that we work with men and with boys. He weeps for his friends and for his community. He rejects the path of retaliative violence. After he is betrayed, he is neither assertive nor vocal, but silent, passive, and yet unafraid. In John's Gospel, Pilate says to the people as Jesus is presented to them for mockery, "Here is the man." If any of us need new gender models, if gender justice can only come as masculinity is itself renewed, if boys and men need to rediscover gender as something personally challenging and transforming, then yes, Jesus is the man. And that's the context in which we can make sense of what Paul says in Galatians, that there's neither Jew nor Greek, nor slave nor free, nor is there male or female, for we're all one in Christ Jesus. At the heart of our faith, a belief in equality, the all-encompassing love of Christ so vast and deep that it overlooks our differences and brings us all together as one. This is our understanding at Christian Aid. And with the example of Jesus in our minds, if we're serious about tackling poverty, we know then that we have to tackle gender inequality. As I said earlier, poverty not just about money, about the uneven distribution of personal, social, and political, as well as economic power. So I want now to focus on each of those four dimensions and explain how we see these things in our work. And I want to start with the lack of personal power, which manifests itself in physical vulnerability. I can tell you a story from every country that I've visited for Christian Aid. One of the things that strikes me, there are two things that strike me, I'll come back to the other later, but one of the things that strikes me wherever I go is the physical vulnerability of the women that I meet. Right from my very, very first story, my very first experience. But the one that encapsulates it probably most neatly is my visit to Nicaragua two or three years back. I don't know, those of you who support Christian Aid Week might remember the Sepeshka coffee making cooperative in Nicaragua. So I go to these coffee producers in the Nicaraguan highlands, and when I was on the way, I was being briefed about the whole background to it. I was told that when we discovered these coffee producers 10 years previously, they'd been on absolutely, really almost broke. They'd almost gone bust, all of them. But we saw that the local organisation that we were working with, Sepeshka, they had a vision for how these communities could be lifted up, how they could be brought together in a cooperative. And by the time I got to see them, they were a thriving, exporting, fair trade coffee producing cooperative. Absolutely amazing. With $500,000 dry processing mill producing this gorgeous fair trade coffee. And, you know, it was just so exciting to see what happens when we partner really well, as we do in Christian Aid, with people who are really ready to pull themselves out of poverty with just a bit of help. On the side of this dry processing mill, it had how much money everybody had put in. I knew it cost a total $500,000, and the Christian Aid amount, I looked for our name, where is our name? Right down at the bottom, $25,000. This is just an aside. I thought, that's a bit cheap. Why don't we give them a bit more than that? That doesn't sound very generous of us. They said, Loretta, don't you get it? The point is, we put a nothing to encourage everybody else to put it in. So we paid for the business plan, and they took that business plan and they took it to other people with our help, and there's other people put all the rest of the money in. We've got to make every penny go as far as possible. So one of the times I really learned how Christian Aid works. We put in enough to help people lift themselves up. And with our help, they have lifted themselves up. They have this wonderful business. And I sat with 30 women whose job it was to do the final sift of the coffee beans before they were packed. And it's quite meticulous work, and they were all very good at this meticulous work, and they were all having an absolutely great time. And they took me to one of their houses. I had a really good session with them. I said, tell me what it means to you to be involved with this business. And they said, we can't begin to tell you how changed our lives are as a result of being involved in this business. Because if you wanted to work in any other coffee mill around here, in the Nicaraguan Highlands, you know, you can't get a job once you're past 30, because no one in management wants to speak with you, no one fancies you, and they won't employ you. You know, this is what it means to be a woman in the Nicaraguan coffee-producing highlands. So next time you ask yourself whether you're going to buy fair trade coffee or whether you're not going to buy fair trade coffee, just spare a thought of the conditions in which people are working to produce the coffee that we take for granted. You know, and one of the wonderful things, by the way, as an aside, that these women told me was with the profits that they make in their business, the women are raising money for health facilities for other women in the area. They have a very high prevalence of cervical cancer for reasons which you might think are maybe obvious. And they are paying for the facilities to screen not just themselves but other women in the communities, and they're paying for education for young women in the communities. You know, love has a habit of replicating itself, and when you empower women, they can do great things and will do great things, as I see it anyway, often for other women too. But you know, women everywhere I go are vulnerable to personal, physical exploitation. Domestic violence and sexual violence against women are major public health problems across the world. Recent global prevalence figures from the WHO indicate that 35% of women worldwide have experienced either intimate partner violence or non-partner sexual violence in their lifetime. On average, 30% of women who've been in a relationship report that they've experienced some form of physical or sexual violence by their partner. In 2013, the UN research based on 10,000 men in Asia found that one in four admitted to have committed a rape, sexual entitlement being the main reason, the belief that men are entitled to sex regardless of consent. Rape is often used as a weapon of war. There's evidence that it rises after natural disasters too. I remember going to Haiti in 2011 and hearing that Haitian women had reported in the camps immediately after the earthquake wearing several pairs of jeans because they were at risk of being raped in their tents. Wearing several pairs of jeans helped them buy time to raise the alarm in the event that they were attacked. Layer onto this the fact that more than 220 million women in developing countries have great difficulty in accessing family planning, which combined with inadequate maternal health care means that pregnancies happen earlier, more frequently, and can be safely managed. Young girls are often becoming pregnant as soon as they start ovulating, long before their bodies are ready. In 2015, there were around 303,000 maternal deaths globally, almost all of them in developing countries. That's the personal power dimension. I want to move on to the social power dimension. Women's place in society in many developing countries is not guaranteed by the law. In still too many countries, women are prevented from doing certain kinds of job, or they have to ask permission from their husbands to embark on a profession or open a business. In many countries, daughters and sons don't have equal inheritance rights, I've mentioned that. And many countries actually don't outlaw domestic or sexual violence. In practice, national laws, even when they exist, are not enforced. In many parts of the world, customary laws and family codes, which are discriminatory, take precedence over national legislation. So whatever the position at the national level on marrying off a girl of 12 to a 60-year-old man, or FGM or honour killing. It may not be outlawed in the traditional legal system, but you know, it's the local law that triumphs where the girl lives. One of the things that I found hardest about the Christian Aid stories for last year, I don't know how many of them you remember from Ethiopia, stories about Adi and Loco in Ethiopia, was the terrible news that those two women shared about what it's like to give birth to a girl. In the community where they lived, they explained that if you had a boy child, it was cause of the most enormous celebration, and everyone would come round and congratulate you and bring gifts, and really a big party would be held. But they explained that if you had a girl child, what you hoped for is that no one would come. That was the best you could hope for, that no one would come. Because what tended to happen was that people came round to express their condolences and their sorrow or their disapproval. And in some countries, having a girl doesn't just entail a series of commiserations. According to the 2011 census in India, there were 927 girls for every 1,000 boys. In 2001, that ratio was worse, only 919 girls for every 1,000 boys. Gender-based terminations are a real thing. That's enough on the social power dimension. I want to move on to the political dimension. I only have to do this briefly, I think, because I think everyone here will appreciate that women are underrepresented at every level of decision-making, which affects them in the political realm right across the world. Only 22% of all national parliamentarians across the world were female as of January 2015. I know that doesn't surprise you because we're all too familiar with that here in the UK. And yes, this is a day on which we have our second female Prime Minister ever. But as of today, only 29% of the House of Commons are female and 25% of the House of Lords. So we're really not doing very much better than the international average. And the fourth dimension is economic. Now, I've mentioned some figures up front about how little women earn compared with men, how much property they own, and so on. I wanted to just highlight just another couple of dimensions of this. One is around tax. Now, you might have thought an issue like tax, that must be more or less gender neutral, but it really, really isn't. I think that you probably know, any of you who followed Christian Aid's work over the past 8 years will know that we've made a huge campaign out of the need for tax justice. There's just much too much tax dodging going on in the world. And if we really want people to stop being dependent on aid, then countries have to be able to stand on their own 2 feet. They have to raise enough tax from the businesses that they have there to pay for essential services like health and education. And the lack of those services often impacts most heavily on women and girls. But one of the things that they do, because there is so much tax dodging, is they resort to the imposition of VAT. In fact, this is advocated by the IMF to poor countries. The IMF says, really, if you're having trouble collecting enough tax, you know, impose more VAT because that's terribly efficient. You know, it's cheap to collect. It's very easy to see where it's owed. You can collect it simply, and that's how you can get the money in. So it matters hugely on what things VAT is imposed. And in 2013, the Kenyan government amended their VAT laws to impose VAT on a long list of essential household items. And the point about this is they were a list of items that were always going to fall to women to buy. So as soon as the tax went on those items, it was the women who were much more heavily impacted. It was, in effect, a gender discriminatory tax. And in April 2014, so just a little while afterwards, thanks to a campaign led by local civil society and supported by Christian Aid and Christian Aid's partners, the Kenyan government passed an amendment to the VAT bill to reinstate exemptions for many of those items, including fertilisers and staple foods. So we really do have to watch what happens with the way tax is imposed, because often that has this gender dimension. And the other big break on economic power for women is the huge burden of unpaid domestic work. A recent project of ours in Ethiopia was typical in identifying that a woman's day involves about 18 hours of work, mostly unpaid, whereas a man did about 7 hours work, mostly paid. Unpaid women's work commonly involves walking miles to collect water and firewood. And because of this burden of work, many girls are not encouraged to complete their education, but rather to help their mothers at home. No wonder then that a girl in South Sudan is more likely to die in childbirth than to finish school. Uneducated girls are less likely to get well-paid work or become politically active, and so the cycle continues. Across all four dimensions then, personal, social, political and economic power, women are discriminated against, and one dimension of poverty feeds another. You see this come together when you look at the implications of climate change for women and girls. And I said I was going to come back to the second thing that strikes me wherever I travel, and that is the impact of climate change on the world's poorest people. But one of the things I didn't appreciate until relatively recently, and then once it's been pointed out to you, you see it everywhere, is that climate change affects women and girls more harshly. Because women are more vulnerable to the floods, droughts and diseases that are expected to increase as the climate changes, that are increasing as the climate changes. Climate change's gender discrimination will be far more pronounced in those swathes of the poorer developing world where sexual inequality is typically much greater, where the effects of global warming are more extreme, and where less money is available to protect against the consequences. Women in poorer countries tend to be more vulnerable because when disaster strikes, they're far more likely to be in the home, cooking, cleaning, or looking after others, putting them at greater risk of collapsing buildings. But that's just one of the many reasons why women tend to suffer disproportionately and natural disasters. Research suggests that women could be considered more vulnerable in severe storms because they're less likely to have been taught to swim in poorer countries, as well as being less likely to own a mobile phone, which could be used to call for help. In the most extreme cases of disasters in patriarchal societies, women may be unable to leave the house without a male companion, or their movement can even be hampered by long clothing. 90% of the 150,000 people killed in the 1991 Bangladesh cyclone were women. You see disproportionate impacts on women in the 2005 tsunami as well. Not only do women typically suffer more than men in the kind of climate-related disasters likely to result from global warming, they're also far more vulnerable to the day-to-day impact of rising temperatures, more exposed to mosquito-borne diseases such as malaria, dengue, and chikungunya, which they come into contact with through duties of water collection and food harvesting that typically fall to them rather than men, and which are transmitted through floods and rising humidity. They're also more likely to go without food in the event of food shortages because of drought, while water scarcity means they sometimes have to travel huge distances to collect water. The task becomes more difficult, requires longer walking distances, heightens the risk of women and girls being assaulted. More importantly, it robs the younger ones of precious time which they could dedicate to their education. If political leaders around the world are serious about poverty, if they're serious about gender equality, they must also get serious about climate change. I've talked a lot about the problems. I want to talk about what I see as being some of the solutions. A very, very important thing happened last autumn. The Millennium Development Goals expired. They weren't perfect, and what's replaced them is potentially much more transformational, the Sustainable Development Goals. I'm not sure whether, in fact, they're very much in anyone's consciousness. But the Sustainable Development Goals, 17 goals, were signed up to by 193 countries. I had the privilege of being in the Hall of the United Nations when they were agreed. And we were so proud to be part of the shaping of those goals, because unlike the NDGs, they are universal. That means they apply here in the UK as well as in every one of the other 192 countries that signed up to them. And they commit us to the eradication of extreme poverty by 2030. They commit us to doing that in a way which leaves no one behind. They are written, if you like, with your statement in mind, that there should be a world in which everybody has their dignity, everyone counts, where identity isn't a barrier to whether or not you can develop, whether or not you can have joy, whether or not you can have dignity. They are amazing, really. They're a kind of secular version of what we, as people of faith, will stand for, in that they do have this picture of a world of equals. So it's really, really important, I think, for us to own those goals and hold politicians to account, having signed up to them. This government signed up to those goals. And, you know, one Prime Minister to another, I'm sorry, but, you know, the government signed up to those goals, and we will hold Theresa May to delivering on them. Goal number five is a goal for gender equality. We fought long and hard for that. We had very, very generous support. One of our great supporters, who was really, really big on gender equality, she died, and with the money that she left in her legacy, we were able really to focus on our advocacy towards the United Nations and towards our government for their position for those Sustainable Development Goals. And we were very proud to be part of the movement that secured a standalone goal for gender equality. And it's not just that there is a goal on gender equality, but actually, in effect, the gender equality is mainstreamed across the goals because of the leave no one behind element of the goals, no goal can be met unless it's also met for women and girls. So I want you to take some time if you can to take a look at those and see, have a think about what you can do to make sure that we hold politicians to account. Get the macro frameworks right, that's a really important starting point. We need to press for laws everywhere which guarantee at the legal level equal pay, equal rights to inherit, outlawing child marriage, FGM and other domestic abuse. And this is something that UN Women, the UN Department, UN Women, is really focusing on. Those legal rights do really matter. And you're hearing a lot of muttering, as I'm hearing a lot of muttering, I'm sure, about how, you know, there may be opportunities now to move away from some of the equality legislation in this country. I hope that we will remind our government that they have signed up to equality for women and girls, they've signed up for leaving no one behind, and that our laws should continue in whatever form to deliver that equality. We have to work with men and boys too. Men and boys are diminished by the diminishing of women and girls. Our models of masculinity are very damaging for men and boys too. And to help kickstart the necessary shifts in cultural understanding, we often start in the field by getting men and women just to talk to each other. But we know that if women find it hard to be good partners, mothers, daughters, sisters, citizens, men also struggle to be good partners, fathers, brothers, sons and citizens too, and to live up to those expectations that society puts on them. And we in our partner organisations get women and men to talk frankly about these pressures and share them. We help them take personal responsibility for a world in which we are all often unwillingly pigeonholed into roles and expectations of behaviour and emotion set from birth. We're all part of the problem. We can all be part of the solution. At the community level, of course, we help women build secure livelihoods. We help them organise. We help them seek political space, stand up for their rights. Yes, access education, decent community healthcare. But our work to end gender inequality from Brazil to Bangladesh is at its heart about tackling relationships between those with power and those without. And we recognise that faith leaders hold great power to foster compassion and positive change within communities. Over the past 70 years, Christian Aid has often partnered with faith leaders, particularly on work to combat HIV and HIV stigma. You know, when HIV was treated as a medical problem, you only had limited success. When you treat it as an issue around social norms and stigma, you can begin to unlock the real source of so much of the problem. And, you know, as we tackled it in countries across Africa and elsewhere, it was working with faith leaders who could get into pulpits and say, actually, you know, HIV is a virus. HIV isn't a sin. The stigma's the sin here. That people could begin to change, that people could see their way to coming forward for counselling, for testing and for treatment. So we know, we knew from that work that faith leaders could play a huge part in tackling the social norms too around gender equality. It's not always a silver bullet to work with faith leaders, because we do know that faith leaders are sometimes part of the problem. But we are trying to seek to change that at Christian Aid. So in March last year, we invited a number of faith-based organisations and institutions to a consultative workshop to discuss ways of addressing gender injustice. And the outcome was a decision to establish a movement of people of faith who will work together to bring about change and create justice and equality for all people regardless of gender. A global inception group began planning, and Side by Side was born, a product of that collaboration. So what does Side by Side do? Well, we recognise that gender justice cannot be achieved by individual efforts alone. Like you, we are a partnership organisation. We therefore work in partnership with other organisations in Side by Side to build a more coordinated, collaborative faith movement, to build greater awareness amongst people of faith, faith leaders and institutions, of the moral and theological imperative for gender justice, and supporting them to demand this of themselves, their own partners, communities and leaders. Side by Side establishes safe spaces for senior faith leaders and champions of gender justice to discuss, understand and commit to take leadership action on gender justice at every level, from the household to the global. And it builds capacity of faith actors to challenge and change harmful social, religious and cultural norms and implement practical activities to address gender injustice. And it's from that very, very humble beginnings of that workshop last March, we've now had workshops in Kenya, in Zimbabwe, in Brazil and elsewhere. And people are beginning to stand up together, feeling equipped and able to say, we stand for gender justice too. And you know, these jurisdictions in which we're starting to make progress, they've got a very, very long way to go. This is a tough, long journey, but I'm amazed about how it's taking off. In Kenya, for example, great social media, this is a tip for all of us, but great use of social media meant that the workshop in Kenya trended on Twitter and got onto the national news. This is what happens when you use these new social media tools well. So, you know, it got really a huge amount of attention in Kenyan media, this little thing that, you know, we got going. We can do that together if we use social media well. We can counter that terrible narrative that we see in so many of our newspapers all the time. So what can you do? I'm talking for too long, but what can you do if you want to support our work? Well, obviously, I would say this, wouldn't I? You can donate. You can donate to Christian Aid. You can donate to Side by Side to help us scale that up and deepen the faith response to gender inequality. You know, donations really, really do help at the community level, the national, international level. You can act. You can sign up to the pledge to support gender justice and find practical faith-based activities to help you promote gender justice in your own community at www.sidebysidegender.org. I think that's right. Anyway, if not, ask me. Or Alice is there as well from Christian Aid. Can you wave your hand, Alice? We'll be able to. I think there might be a leaflet over there about Side by Side. And we'd ask you to pray. We provide, perhaps you make your own as well, we provide prayer resources and materials for theological reflection, including on our website, and please do, if you'd like, to take Susan's work of the same flesh home with you tonight. I started at the beginning by saying that 50 years ago it would have been thought an idle fantasy to imagine that I would be here today as the female chief exec of a large international development organisation. When I visited our programme in Bangladesh in 2012, I stood in front of 200 incredible women who had worked together and planned and collaborated to rebuild their community after Cyclone Ida. and their lead spokeswoman, when she stood up, she nearly couldn't speak at all when she stood up to make her presentation. And then she pulled herself together and she said, "I'm sorry, it's just that I never imagined I would be standing here talking to someone like you." And I said, "It's okay, I never imagined I'd be given the chance to be here either." It's that sense of shifting the power which moves me and gets me excited. It's the change we all want to see. It's the change that, in a way which wasn't really possible before, we can now be a part of. I'd like to ask you to consider how you could help secure gender justice for the world's very poorest women and girls. I don't know what will be the best way for you, but I do know this. Whether it's local, national, or global change we're looking for, it starts with us. It's through the goodwill and involvement of individuals like you, working together, that we can collectively make a difference in our world. And if you'd asked me to give a one-word answer to the title of this lecture, "Does Poverty Have a Woman's Face?" it's abundantly clear, I think, from the examples that I've given you, that yes, in one sense, it does. Because numerically, it's a discrimination that affects so many. But as I explained, we're really talking about the misdistribution of power and discrimination on the grounds of sexuality, an issue I know concerns us all deeply, is another such driver of poverty. And all groups marginalised by identity, whether race, creed, colour, disability, caste, or anything else, they all suffer disproportionately from poverty. Because it's about injustice unredressed by love. It mars the image of God in each one of us. It takes from us the place at the table which Jesus laid for each one of us as equals. Do you dare to dream? Because I do. It might be interesting to imagine how different the world would be if everyone actually believed that though we're all different, we all matter equally, that we are irreplaceable. It's a message I think in this country we need to hear loud and clear right now. Every person matters equally. We are all irreplaceable. On the front of Christian Aid's strategy document, Partnership for Change, there's the soaring words of Psalm 99. "Lover of justice, you have established equity." From that notion of equity, that we, whilst different, are all equal because we're all made in the image of God, from that notion flow the joy, the energy, and the purpose of all Christian Aid's work. Once we realise this truth, we can rally together to love our global neighbours as the uniquely beautiful and worthy people that they are. And then we can share in some great good news in a world with which, with your help, poverty, although too prevalent, they're reinforced by economic models, conflicts and disasters which have taken us backwards. Poverty need not have a woman's face. Indeed, poverty need not have a face at all.